Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at LoveIsrael.org. That's one word, LoveIsrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
We know that the last days are quickly approaching, and therefore we need to be ready. We also need to know, as we learned last week and many other times, that these last days for believers are going to be very difficult. And obviously, we are not talking about God's wrath. We have a promise. The Apostle Paul makes it very clear that those who have received the gospel, believers in Messiah, his disciples, will not experience God's wrath. But that does not mean there will not be intense persecution in the last days before our blessed hope, the rapture, takes place. And therefore, we need to be ready. We saw a few weeks ago that Messiah, 2,000 years ago, he sent forth his disciples, giving them authority, granting them power against the enemy to bring about a restoration, to give a manifestation of the kingdom of God in order to draw people unto the truth, in order that they might receive that only message of salvation, the gospel. And in doing so, we see that there was an emphasis in the last days. We concluded last week with that statement that these faithful individuals in the last days who are taking the gospel to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, they will be persecuted, they will be rejected, they will go from one city to another, but they will not complete all of Israel going through all the communities until the Son of Man returns. And therefore, we need to have the right perspective. And what is that right perspective? Well, take out your Bible and look with me to the Gospel according to Matthew and chapter 10. The Gospel according to Matthew and chapter 10. Look with me to that next verse where we concluded last week, the next verse, verse 24. And he's speaking to disciples. Now, this is true always, but it's going to have an additional relevance for those disciples in the last days. And that may mean you and me. So he says here, verse 24, a disciple is not above the teacher, nor a servant. And this word servant is like a bond servant. It can also be thought of as a slave, and it speaks about being in absolute submissiveness to the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. A disciple recognizes Yeshua, that is, Jesus Christ, as the master of his life. So he says, a disciple is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. Then look at verse 25. Has this word enough or sufficient? And this has a degree of satisfaction. What he's talking about here should be enough to satisfy us. And what should please us, satisfy, what should be enough that we are thought of as Messiah's servants, his disciples. What he went through, we also went through. And the scripture's clear. Messiah says, they hated me, they're going to hate my followers. They persecuted me, they're going to persecute my followers. Again, that's you and me. So he says here in this scripture, look at verse 25, he writes, enough for the disciple. That this one should be as his teacher, also the servant as his master. And then he gives us a framework to understand how the world is going to view followers of Yeshua in the last days. Notice what he says here in that last part of verse 25. Since the master or the owner of the house, they called him who? Beelzebub. Now, this is a Hebrew term from the word Baal, which means master, and Zevuv, which is fly. And it is a term that speaks of Satan or the devil in a colloquial sense. So we have seen, because of the good things that Messiah did, people called him Beelzebub. That is, called him and said he received his power, his authority, his ability to do miracles. And these were good things, good deeds that brought about a restoration to the things of God. And they called him what? Beelzebub. And therefore it says, how much more so his members, that is, the members of his house. So we are going to be slandered. We are going to be spoken against, and we need to realize that. And here's the key. Not allow such slander, such words, to turn us away from following in obedience. We should expect this. And we're seeing more and more opposition to the things of God. And here's something so valuable to realize. We're seeing, even within those who are supposedly part of the body of Messiah, the congregation of the redeemed, what we call the church, also turning against those who embrace a fidelity to the word of God. We will see, as Paul says, there is an apostasy coming. That is a falling away from that which is good, that which is correct, the right doctrine, falling away into a religion that is not grounded in the word of God, that does not reflect the truth of Scripture. And therefore, those who say yes to God's word, those who do not worry about being politically correct, those who do not change or conform to the pressures of the world, they're going to be called Beelzebub. They are going to be thought of as those who are against the truth, when in reality, we are the ones who are expressing the truth. So do not be surprised by these changes, and we can already see the beginning of these changes, and things are only going to get worse in the near future. Let's press on to the next verse, verse 26. Now here again, this scripture that we're looking at, remember the end of verse 23. It says, you won't go through all the cities of Israel until the Son of Man comes. And this is referring to our blessed hope, him removing the congregation of redeemed from this world prior to, as Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5:9, prior to the wrath of God falling upon this world. So notice what he says in this verse, verse 26. He says here, therefore, in light of all of this, he says, therefore, do not, and it's speaking of a personal faith, do not fear them. When he says do not fear, he means be faithful. He says do not turn away, and here's an important truth. When we look at the concept of fear, scripturally, we find from the Hebrew language, there's two words for fear. One is yirah, which is the fear of the Lord. It's giving God priority. And when we give God the priority of our life, we are going to be propelled to the things of God, his purposes, his desires, his will. But when we are afraid of the world, that is, when we stop being ones who recognize God's priority, and we give the world priority, wanting to agree with them, when we're afraid of those that belong into the world, we're going to turn away from the truth of God. So here, look at this scripture, verse 26. He says, therefore, in light of what we learned, therefore, you be not afraid of them. For nothing which is concealed, literally, nothing which has been concealed. Now realize something. The Antichrist, just like his leader, Satan, is a father of lies, distortion. He is going to conceal the truth. But realize, there is coming a time when that which is concealed, what does it says here? For nothing which has been concealed, it's not going to be what? It's not going to be concealed forever. It is rather going to be revealed. And that which is hidden, it says, it will be made known. Will it not be made known? And it is. So there's coming a time of revelation. When God, and here's the key, when God judges this world, he will put things in order, a restoration, what we say in Hebrew, a tikkun olam, repairing the world. And one very important part of this restoration is truth. There is going to be a revealing of that which is right and a condemnation, a judgment upon that which is incorrect, that which is unrighteous, that which is in conflict with the Word of God. So just because things are concealed, there is deceit, there is falsehood, we know. False teachers, false prophets in the last days. And they are going to go out, as John says, they are going to go out from us. And that is put within the context of the work of the Antichrist. They're going to go out from us because they were not part of us. So expect these things. These are important that we understand what's going to happen. Look now to verse 27. What I say, and again, Yeshua is speaking, what I say to you in darkness. Now, what do you think he's referring to here? What I say to you in darkness. Well, that's nighttime. And nighttime is the most appropriate time for prayer. At nighttime, people would emphasize prayer. And prayer is not just making your supplications known to God, but prayer is also you listening to God, hearing from him, understanding through revelation God's will. And what the scripture says, read this carefully. We read in verse 27, that I say to you, whatever I say to you in darkness, you say, and this is a commandment, you say in light. What does that mean, in light? In the day. So as we pray throughout the night, did not several times Yeshua, he himself would find that quiet place and he would pray throughout the night. We talked about that. As we follow that example, emphasizing night for not just sleep, not just for television and things, leisure, but we emphasize prayer. We're going to see how God instructs us, teaches us, reveals things to us, and we are called to reveal them in light, that is, in the midst of the day. We don't want anything concealed. We are about truth and revealing it. So once more, verse 27, what I say to you in darkness, you say in the light. And what in the ear you hear, you proclaim upon the housetops. So once more, it's all about revealing something, not to be shy, not to be quiet, not to let someone quiet you from sharing the truth. We're called to speak out what God instructs us, what God reveals to us, so that we are a source of revelation. We are vessels of light in order to war against the darkness that's coming upon this world. These are important instructions for believers. When? In the last days. We need to realize that. Be prayerful in our preparation for this time of service. And I believe in a very unique way, we are coming close to those days. We need to be ready. Move on now to verse 28. Once more he says, also do not fear from the ones who can kill the body, but, remember that word, but, it's in contrast. Do not fear the ones who can kill the body. And why is that? Because many believers are going to be put to death. But we need to have the right mindset, the right truth, meditate upon that, understand that. And that's what he's giving us. Verse 28, and do not fear, and it's personal, you do not fear from the ones who can kill the body, but the soul they are not able to kill, but rather you fear the one, and this is of course God, who's able the soul and the body to make perish, that is to destroy, where? In hell, in Gehenna. So God makes it very clear. Do not be individuals that worry about the death of the body. Why shouldn't we? Because we believe in a resurrection. And again, as we go through this section, we see over and over, the context is being put to death, being hated, being persecuted, being slandered, all of these things. And he tells us a few times, he says, you do not fear, but rather do what? Speak truth. Realize there is a time coming of revelation, that God is going to make known what is right and what is wrong. That is a kingdom restoration. So we don't fear what happens to our body, and he wants to give us more encouragement why we ought not. So let's press on. Look at the next verse. Verse 29, he asks a question. Are not two sparrows, are they not sold for a small coin? So are not two sparrows sold for a small coin? But he says, not one from them should fall to the ground except or apart from your Father, meaning, whatever happens, God either allows that or he's the cause of it. But be assured of this. He knows it. He's aware of it. Nothing surprises him. And whatever takes place, if he allows it, he's going to use it. So he's aware of the value of a sparrow. And notice what he says. Two, not even one, but two are sold for the smallest coin. So one has almost no worth whatsoever, but our Heavenly Father, he's aware of each one of them. They cannot die unless he's aware of it. Furthermore, he says, keep reading, verse 29, the second half, where he says, but apart from your Father, not one of them falls unless he's aware of it. Now, verse 30, but you, he says, also, the hair of your head, all is numbered. Imagine that. He says, in regard to every human being, God knows everything about us, unto the extent, even the hair on our head, everyone is numbered. He is intimately aware of every aspect of my life. What's going on? What's happening to me? What others are plotting against me, he's aware of that. And here's another important truth that we need to be remindful of. Look at verse 31. He says, therefore, as a result of this, therefore you do not be afraid. Don't fear. Why shouldn't we? Because he says, more than sparrows you surpass. Now, this is a word to bring or to carry. And what he's speaking about is this. We bring far more value than a sparrow. So if he's aware of everything about a sparrow, a small, very inexpensive bird, how much more so us? So do not be afraid. Why? God is with me. How do I know God's with me? Because I have a covenant relationship with him. And what else? My utmost desire is to be a servant of his, to walk in his ways, to fulfill his purposes. That's what the fear of the Lord is all about. So we read here that God is aware that we are far more valuable than a sparrow. Look now to verse 32. Therefore, everyone who confesses me before men, he says, also I will confess him before my Father in heaven. Isn't that wonderful? Everyone who confesses him, that's what we need to do. We need to be people that have confessed him, received that gospel message, and be willing to confess him. Why is this what he's saying? Because there's going to come a time, and in many other countries, it's already here. And that is how dangerous it is to be a follower of Messiah, to confess him, that I belong to him, that I'm in a covenant relationship with him. But realize something. When your faith is a public faith, when you are willing to suffer for your faith, how precious that faith is. And he makes us a promise here. Everyone who confesses him publicly before men, notice what he says, also I will confess him before my Father in heaven. But notice the warning. He says, verse 33, but whomsoever should deny me before men, I will deny him also I before my Father in heaven. So we need to be people that speak truth, that live out our faith and boldly proclaim that we are a follower of Messiah Yeshua. Now, before we wrap up, there's one more point that I want to make. How what we read here is so against what some people are teaching about believers. There is a saying today, it's not new, but it speaks about a triumphant church. Now, what they mean by that, and I believe in a triumphant church, but here's the key. I believe in it because of the resurrection. Our victory, our triumph is laying down our life for our faith. That's not our defeat. That is going to be a glorious badge of honor at the time of the resurrection. So we don't need to worry about losing our life. In fact, we're called to be living a life of sacrifice, being willing to lay down our life for our faith. And here's the problem. There are people teaching today that the church is going to be triumphant. And what do they mean by that? That the church is going to convert the world. That we are going to be so successful that we're going to see nation after nation after nation turn to Messiah. That they're going to become a believing nation. But here's the problem. We don't see that prophetically. That's a nice thought. Now, the danger is this. We, even though we can be assured of something, what is the prophetic truth? The prophetic truth is this. It says, Zechariah tells us that every nation in the world is going to turn against Israel in the last days and go up to Israel to make war. Being against the Jewish people and their right to the land. And who's going to be leading them to do that? I hope you know the answer. It's the Antichrist. So every nation, that tells us, that nations are not going to be brought to faith. Does that mean that we don't try? Here's the key. We're interested in the individual. The fact that every nation in the world is going to turn against God and attack his covenant people, the Jewish people, and attack Jerusalem, his city. See, I was listening to an individual just the other day, and he was teaching, and he was so incorrect. That the church replaces Israel that nation after nation, we're going to be triumphant, that we're going to see nation after nation come to faith. But here's the problem. All of his belief is devoid of any prophecy. He denies all of the future prophecies as it's all in the past. It's all been fulfilled. No, it's not. What we see is this. Nations, all of them, are going to turn against the purposes of God. And they are going to go to war against Israel, against the Jewish people. And they're going to fight for Jerusalem. And what do we know? Messiah is going to come back. He is going to defeat that army, that coalition of all the armies in the world. But that doesn't mean that we say, well, we're not going to win the nation, so we're just going to give up. Of course not. Because we're not called to save nations, we're called to save individual souls. To spread that gospel one person at a time. God is a God of the remnant. See, his view is, and so many people are falling into this false teaching. See, there's not going to be some great spiritual awakening that happens in the last days. Nowhere do we see that. What we see is this, that there's going to be a remnant that comes to faith from every nation, every tribe, every tongue, every people. That's who we're called. Now, we don't know who that remnant is, so we speak it to all people, going to every nation. But realize, nations are not going to come to faith. We're not going to see governments converted. We're not going to see academic institutions be strongholds of faith. I wish it would, but that's not prophetically what the Word of God reveals to us. No, times are going to get difficult, and we are going to be called to do what? Just what the Scripture says, to take up our cross and follow after him. The Antichrist is going to, says it twice in the book of Revelation, make war with the saints and overcome us. That's okay. Because just like Messiah's death on the cross did not defeat him, our physical death, the one who kills our body, so what? We're interested in the soul and a new body. And that is the message that the gospel deals with. That it is going to redeem our souls and give us a new body at that right time. And what is the nature of that new body? It's a body perfectly designed for the kingdom of God. So let's have the right perspective for what's going to happen in the last days. Well, I'm out of time. Until next week, Shalom from Israel.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of LoveIsrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, LoveIsrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.